Hello, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. We are going to be going live at 4 o'clock. Okay, so we will be going live in 40 seconds.
This is Joey Truax of the Best Part of Hip Hop 101, and you are listening to Radio Lex, the voice of the people, WLXU 93.9 FM, LPFM, Lexington.
The views expressed on this program are not necessarily the views of Lexington Community Radio or its board of directors. The views expressed are solely those of the programmers.
You are listening to Off the Cuff. Now, here's your host, Adam Banks.
Welcome, everybody, to Off the Cuff. I am Adam Banks coming at you live from Lexington, Kentucky. Thank you for listening to the show, and thank you for tuning in to WLXU 93.9 FM. In addition to listening to us on the radio, you can check out our Facebook live stream at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks, or you could stream the show live from the station website at radiolex.us. It is February the 1st, 2024. Thank you, everyone, for listening to another live radio broadcast, the first day of February, and I'll take this weather any day. My watch is saying 55 degrees, and it's funny that 55 degrees now feels like 75 degrees because of how cold it has been. It's weird how that happens, how when you are so used to cold and then you'd have a little, just a like a burst of heat, it feels like a heat wave. But I will take it all day. Every day. Folks, I usually love when wrestling is in the news. Everyone who knows me knows that I love wrestling. I love casinos. I love poker. I love college basketball. And I love wrestling. Wrestling used to be my right at the tippy top of favorite things to like. And whenever wrestling is in the news, I usually get really excited because that means I get to talk about it. But it just depends on what all is the topic is talking about. And unfortunately, wrestling has had the spotlight on it because of everything happening with the owner of the WWE, Vince McMahon. But before I get to Vince and the wrestling business, Monday Night Raw, which is the prime main show of the WWE, is moving to Netflix for the first time since its debut 31 years ago. It's leaving cable television. Think about that. Wrestling has been known to be one of the staples of cable television since the creation of wrestling. It's always been on cable TV. And Monday Night Raw is the main show for the WWE. And it's always been on cable. It's been on the USA Network for the majority of its duration. But just with like everything else, TV seems to be dying down. Cable, for that matter, just seems to be dying down. Shows that are streaming seem to be more successful. It seems that people are trying to get more shows on streaming services than they are television networks nowadays because streaming just seems to be what people do. Wrestling and Vince McMahon, wrestling's always been an innovator. Vince McMahon's always been an innovator. They started this streaming service, the WWE Network, back in 2012, 2013, and they were really one of the first sports entities to go to streaming. And now look at all the sports streaming services you have out there. A lot of sports are now showing their games on streaming only. For instance, the NFL is that you can only watch Thursday Night Football if you tune in to Amazon Prime. I know that they had a huge playoff game to see who's going to go to the Super Bowl. They had it on the Peacock Network. So sporting events are not even on cable television anymore. They're switching to streaming services. And wrestling seems to be the next thing to go exclusively to streaming. And I think that this is going to be the first of many sports entities to go to a streaming-only service. It's only a matter of time before you will have to get streaming in order to watch a certain sport. NBA, college basketball, MLB. One day, and I predict this day to be very quickly in the future, one day a sport is going to completely go off of cable television and onto streaming. So if you don't like it, you're going to have to learn to like it because if you want to continue to watch it, you're just going to have to roll with the times. It says here that Monday Night Raw will begin streaming exclusively on Netflix. In the United States, Canada, and the UK, among other territories, beginning January 2025. The WWE announced a long-term partnership last week to fold more WWE programming into the streaming service. Netflix will become the home for all WWE shows and specials outside the U.S. as they become available, including SmackDown, NXT, and pay-per-views. WWE documentaries, original series, and upcoming projects will also be available on Netflix internationally beginning next year. So right now the WWE has a streaming service. It's called the WWE Network, and they merged with the Peacock streaming service. So you have to subscribe to Peacock to get the WWE Network. But now that WWE Raw is moving exclusively to Netflix, it makes you wonder, is the whole Peacock thing going away? I would say probably so. It says here that the two parties reportedly struck a 10-year deal worth approximately $5 billion. So the WWE and Netflix are both going to benefit from this $5 billion deal. It says that the partnership fundamentally alters and strengthens the media landscape, dramatically expanding the reach of WWE and brings weekly live appointment viewing to Netflix. And that's something that's going to benefit Netflix. Netflix doesn't have a lot of shows that are appointment viewing. Usually they just put everything all at once up on their streaming service and you can binge watch. Well, Monday Night Raw is going to be still appointment setting. You have to tune into Netflix from 9 to 11 or 9 to 12, however late they have Raw these days, to actually watch the show still. So it's going to give Netflix some appointment television, so kind of bringing it back old school. But that, folks, is just one thing going on in the wrestling world. There's also this thing with Vince McMahon. Now, everybody probably knows by now, Vince McMahon has stepped down as the chairman of the board for TKO Group Holdings Incorporated, and that's the company formed by Endeavor that merged WWE and the UFC. So last year, if you remember, Vince McMahon merged the WWE with the UFC, and because of that, a new company was formed called TKO. And Vince McMahon stayed relevant because he was the chairman of the board. And let's be honest, the chairman of the board is the boss. He is the main man. Well, since new allegations have come about, has come up against Vince McMahon, he has stepped down as the chairman of the board. So for the first time in the history of wrestling, according to WWE, that is, no McMahon has any affiliation with the company. The lawsuit was filed days after it was announced that WWE had secured a deal with Netflix to begin airing Monday Night Raw beginning in 2025. So just when that news broke, there was some more news broke that there was a lawsuit by a former WWE female employee against the former owner of the WWE, Vince McMahon. Basically, she was saying that she was used as a sex toy for a lot of future WWE talent. Vince McMahon used her almost trafficked her, in a sense, to fulfill his own personal needs, to fulfill future talent needs, and to fulfill current executive needs. It says here that Janelle Grant is the lady who filed the lawsuit against the company, and it mentions Vince McMahon, and the executive that she specifically mentioned was John Laurinaitis, which is a longtime WWE official, and the lawsuit alleges that McMahon abused and sexually exploited her and trafficked her to other men, including Laurinaitis, who used to be the former head of talent relations. It says here, according to Grant's lawsuit, McMahon and Laurinaitis on WWE property, after using WWE funding, both engaged in sexual assault and trafficking of Grant, both for their own pleasure and as a pawn to secure talent deals with prospective wrestlers they were recruiting. Vince McMahon obviously says it's all fake. Vince McMahon says that he is used to getting lied on, but he says that this lawsuit is replete with lies. He says, quote, "I stand by my prior statement that Ms. Grant's lawsuit is replete with lies, obscene, made-up instances that never occurred, and is a vindictive distortion of the truth." He said, "I intend to vigorously defend myself against these baseless accusations and look forward to clearing my name. However, out of respect for the WWE universe and the extraordinary TKO business, he is going to resign from the chairman's seat." So, listen, Vince McMahon, say what you want about him. We have wrestling because of him. But if Vince McMahon is responsible for what this former employee is alleging, then he's a terrible person. Anybody who forces anybody to do anything against their will is a terrible person. Now, why this girl, this lady that filed the lawsuit, kept supposedly coming back and participating in these sexual acts is beyond me. I don't know the whole story. But regardless, you should see these messages that I read from Vince McMahon, because the text messages are on the internet. They are way too explicit for me to read. But the things that he said to her, it boggles my mind. For one, it boggles my mind that he would leave a trail like that behind. It seems like somebody in his position, somebody as smart as Vince, he would be more wary as to who he sends a text to. Because when you text people, there's a record of that. When you email people, there's a record of that. So it really makes no sense to me that Vince would be that just just careless when texting this lady. According to the lawsuit, McMahon lived in the same building as Grant and in 2019 offered to get her a job at WWE after her parents died. She alleged that he eventually made it clear that one of the requirements of the job was a physical relationship with him and later with Laurinaitis and others. Over the next few years, McMahon lavished her with gifts, including a luxury car, the suit says. It also alleges that McMahon offered one of his star wrestlers, a person not named in the lawsuit, sex with Grant as a perk in 2021. Grant is seeking unspecified monetary damages and to have the court void a $3 million non-disclosure agreement, of which she alleges she received only $1 million. But because of that, because of everything happening with Vince, he is officially no longer a part, and probably, folks, will never again be a part of the company that he built. Think about that. Vince McMahon no longer being involved in wrestling. When you turn on the WWE, just know that that's no longer a Vince McMahon show. Yes, he created it. He made it to what it is today. But he no longer is a part of that company. And there's been other people that has made and built companies that's been fired from them. I know that Steve Jobs created Apple and eventually was fired by the board of directors of his own company. The same thing pretty much happened to Vince. He didn't get fired, but it was almost like a forced resignation. But it is truly, truly an end of an era in the wrestling world. But folks, we have a great show ahead of you today. Stick with us. You are listening to Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. We will be right back.
You are listening to Radio Lex, WLXU, 93.9, LPFM, Lexington, Kentucky.
Radio Lex has the support of CD sponsor Dominique Wright. Thanks, Dominique. Radio Lex has the support of corner sponsor Central Bank. CentralBank.com.
Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. This is the infamous theme music of the character Mr. McMahon, who, say what you want about him, the greatest heel to ever be in wrestling. And it's funny, isn't it, that Vince McMahon ended up being one of the best creations that he ever created was just playing himself. Vince McMahon, when he was losing the ratings back in the 90s to Ted Turner in WCW, he decided to put himself on camera as a character, the Vince McMahon character, the Mr. McMahon character, where he was the evil boss. And because of that, he became one of the best bad guys in wrestling history. And folks, I'm not on here today to praise the man because all of these allegations against him is pretty horrible. But the years that I watched Vince McMahon on television as a performer, he will certainly go down as one of the greatest wrestling characters of all time. The Mr. McMahon character was without a doubt the best heel of all time, the best bad guy of all time. And Vince McMahon was one of the best talkers on the microphone. He could cut a promo better than any person that he had on his own roster. So, in light of everything happening to Vince McMahon, and because Vince McMahon will no longer cut any more promos in the wrestling world, I thought I would pay homage to some of the best Vince McMahon promos of all time. Cutting a wrestling promo is not easy because you're going up against an audience, and a wrestling audience can be tough. It can be a tough crowd. They'll let you know right off the bat if they love you or hate you. And sometimes it's really hard to get heat, to be a bad guy, to get booed. And I'm talking about not a getting booed because you're boring. I'm talking about getting booed because the audience hates you. It's hard to get the audience to hate you, but it was so easy to hate Vince McMahon because he was so good. And one of the reasons Vince McMahon became one of the best bad guys in wrestling was because of his feud with the top guy, Stone Cold Steve Austin. So the majority of these promos, these Vince McMahon promos that I'm going to play, involves him and Stone Cold Steve Austin. Now, this first promo that I'm going to play is one of the best Vince McMahon promos of all time. I'm going to call this promo, "It Was Me, Austin." And I'll give you a backstory before I play this promo. So, The Undertaker had this group called the Corporate Ministry, and they were running all over the WWE, destroying everyone. They even tried to sacrifice Mr. McMahon's daughter, Stephanie, with a wedding to The Undertaker. Vince McMahon, because of this, had been teaming with Stone Cold Steve Austin for the first time ever to protect his family against The Undertaker and his evil ministry led by the greater power. But it turned out that Vince McMahon was actually the greater power, and he was in on it with The Undertaker. So all of this bad stuff that happened to his daughter and his wife getting hurt and his son getting beat up, this whole time, Vince made people think that he was teaming up with Stone Cold to fight against the ministry, but this whole time, he was the higher power. So in this particular promo that he cut, Vince McMahon is standing in the ring. Nobody knows who the higher power is. The person standing there in the ring dressed in a robe. Nobody can see who it is, and that they're about to reveal who the greater power is. Nobody has an idea or even a clue that it would be Vince because of all the horrible things that happened to him and his family. So when he unveiled that it was him and he started screaming, "It was me, Austin, it was me," and then he continues to cut one of the best promos in wrestling history. And one of the things that I love specifically about this clip is Jim Ross on commentary, they never told him what was going to happen in the show because they wanted his authentic, genuine reaction. And hearing Jim Ross find out that it was Vince, because Jim Ross loves Stone Cold, and anybody that went against Stone Cold, JR would go nuts. But I love hearing JR's reaction when he finds out it's Vince. But take a listen to this promo when Vince McMahon revealed to be in on it, to be the higher power, actually being the one to go against and hurt his family just so he could get Stone Cold Steve Austin and make his life hell. Take a listen at this epic Vince McMahon promo.
Your life here on Earth, Austin, a total, complete
Yes. Don't you love the intensity from Vince McMahon? Listen at that crowd. Listen at how loud and how much they were booing when they found out that it was Vince in on it the whole time. They hated him, and it was all just to get to Stone Cold Steve Austin. Okay, this next promo that I'm going to play is one of the best Vince McMahon promos of all time. I like to call this one, "I Will Fire You, Stone Cold. I Will Fire You." And this one comes from October 8th, 1998. And this is in the middle and in the prime of the Austin versus McMahon feud. And Vince McMahon's sole purpose was to keep Stone Cold from being the WWF champion. So what had happened was he finally made Stone Cold lose the title. So there was a new title match between The Undertaker and Kane, and Vince McMahon wanted to humiliate Stone Cold and make Stone Cold the referee of the match to determine who's going to be the champion, because nobody knew who the champion was, because it was because Kane and The Undertaker both pinned Stone Cold at the same time. So Stone Cold had to referee the match between The Undertaker and Kane at the upcoming pay-per-view to determine who the next champion was going to be. And Stone Cold said he wasn't going to do that. But Vince McMahon said, if you don't raise the hand of a new champion, I will fire you, Stone Cold. So take a listen to this promo, October 8th, 1998. And what's so special and great about this promo is because, again, you can hear the intensity. You can hear the volume of the audience just hating Vince McMahon. But listen at Vince on the mic. He is so good at just being the bad guy. He is so good at being hated. The best heel of all time. Take a listen at this promo from 98. Hit the music. There you go. And the intensity from the chairman of the board to the top star, Stone Cold. Now, doesn't that make you want to rent the pay-per-view to see what was going to happen? That's why hundreds of thousands of people did rent the pay-per-view. And guess what? He did fire Stone Cold because Stone Cold did not raise the hand of a new champion. All right, the next promo that I'm going to let you hear of Vince McMahon is one of the best Vince McMahon promos of all time. I want to call this promo, "I Want the Old Stone Cold Back." And this comes from 2001, July 12th, 2001. And the backstory of this is the WWF at the time had an invasion from the WCW, where they were invaded by the rival company. And because of this, Vince McMahon needed his top guys to go against WCW's top guys, because there was going to be a match at the next pay-per-view, and basically whoever won this match was going to be the new leader in wrestling. So they took the best five from WCW and the best five from WWE to fight. But the best that WWE had was Stone Cold Steve Austin. But the thing about it is the previous 6 months before the invasion, Stone Cold was a bad guy and he was a heel. And he teamed up with Vince McMahon and was a corporate butt kisser. He was a brown noser. He wasn't his old self. He wasn't coming out and stunning people, hitting people over the head with chairs. He wasn't doing anything that he used to do. He used to hug Vince. He used to have his wife bake Vince cookies. And Vince was trying to give Stone Cold Steve Austin in this particular promo a motivational speech where he was trying to get the old Stone Cold back. And he was begging the old Stone Cold to come back. And this might be some of Vince McMahon's best work. Take a listen.
Even though I appreciate it as not a Stone Cold Steve Austin who gives me hugs, I don't need the leader of Team WWF, the Stone Cold Steve Austin, that gives me gifts, cowboy hats, and Steve, you had your wife Deborah make me cookies. Steve, I don't need the kind of Stone Cold Steve Austin that strums a guitar and sings to me to lead me and lead Team WWF into invasion. That's not what I need, Steve. Damn it. You know what I need. You know who I need. I need the old Stone Cold. Stone Cold Steve Austin, who's a beer swilling, foul mouth, that's all big.
And damn right we need it.
I need the kind of Stone Cold Steve Austin who don't take no from anybody.
You come on, bitch.
I need the kind of hell raising Stone Cold Steve Austin. Not that long ago, that would look at Mr. McMahon, and if I parted my hair the wrong way, you would knock me on my... Not the kind of leadership I need from you, Stone Cold. I need you to lead Team WWF into invasion. I need the old Stone Cold. Are you listening to me, dammit? Huh? Do you want to knock me on my... Now? Come on. I can feel it. I know I can feel it. I can feel it in my guts. Come on. Come on. Nail me. Come on. Knock me down. Knock me down. If you want Stone Cold Steve Austin to beat the living hell out of Vince McMahon, give me a hell yeah.
And Stone Cold just shakes his head no and puts his head down and walks away. But eventually, Stone Cold snaps out of it and becomes the old Stone Cold again. But because of that, we got to see the greatest man on the mic at work, Vince McMahon. And he's so good at it. He's so talented and just so in your face with it. It just blows my mind. Okay, here's another great Vince McMahon promo, because Vince McMahon is so good at promos. This one is a backstage interview that he did with Jim Ross in 1997. And some say it was this interview that created the Mr. McMahon character. It was this interview that made Vince McMahon a bad guy. And before this interview, Vince McMahon was not on camera as a character. He was known as the owner, and he was particularly just an announcer at ringside. But at the Survivor Series 1997, Bret Hart was supposed to drop the title on the script. It was scripted that he was supposed to drop the title, and he was supposed to go to the rival company of Vince McMahon. So Vince wanted him to drop the title. Well, Bret Hart said that he wasn't going to drop the title because he didn't want to lose the title in his home country of Canada. So he refused to drop the title, and Vince was afraid that if he let Bret Hart walk out of the Survivor Series with the WWE title, that he would show up on WCW television with the WWE belt and drop it in the trash. and that would just devalue the WWE Championship. So Vince McMahon decided to basically just double-cross Bret Hart in the middle of the match and just take the title from him without him even knowing. And in real life, he took the title from Bret by telling the referee to ring the bell. And the next night, they interviewed Vince about it, and Vince gave this infamous interview. It's called Bret Screwed Bret, and I love it. Take a listen. That's what I'm going to start saying about people when they want to say that I screwed them over. I'm going to say, no, you screwed you. Whatever your name is, let's say it's Alan. I'm going to say Alan screwed Alan. Alan screwed Alan. All right, one more here to play for the audience. And I feel like that this one is a good one to end on because this is also back from 1998. And I feel like this is a good promo to end on because this is Vince McMahon telling everybody that he will never retire or step down as the chairman of the company. And it just seems fitting because he did step down as the chairman of the company. But he says that when he does, well, I'll just let you listen. Take a listen. That is some of the best Vince McMahon promos of all time. And we'll never hear another one. But I feel like that there are so many more to play, so many great ones. But because of the sake of time, those I feel like were some of the best to play. If he did do what he did, shame on him, and he's a terrible person. But the legacy and impact that he left on wrestling will always be unmatched. All right, folks, we still have lots more Off the Cuff with Adam Banks coming at you live after these words. Stick with us. We will be right back.
Hey, I'm Lily Rochelle, and this is Radio Lex, the voice of the people. WLXU 93.9 FM in Lexington. Let's go places safe like Lexington. Are you a teenage driver? If you are, you're at risk. Teen drivers have the highest rate of fatal crashes. The number one factor of these collisions is not paying attention. Hi, I'm Johanna Reyes from Toyota, reminding you to eliminate distractions and keep your eyes and mind on the road.
Radio Lex needs you. Independent community radio thrives because of listeners just like you. Visit radiolex.us/volunteer to become part of the voice of the people. From producing programming to helping us with the day-to-day, or support Lexington's community radio with a financial contribution. Visit radiolex.us/donate and support Radio Lex right now. Do you have enough room on the road? Do your best to keep a safe distance buffer between you and the car behind you. What's a safe distance? Use the 2-second rule. Choose any marker on the side of the road, a sign, a cone, a mile marker.
See.
From the time the rear bumper
in
front of you
passes
the
marker, Teresa.
Make sure you can count 2 seconds before you
reach
the marker with the front of your car.
Elaine, I am so sorry.
This is Deborah Hensley with State Farm, reminding you to be a good neighbor and leave a safe
distance
between your car and others on the road.
Well, I'm so glad that you joined the live. I swear, that is so horrible to hear, Elaine.
Radiolex has the support of vinyl sponsors.
Well, I'm so glad that you're here.
Wiley,
I hope you're enjoying the show.
Thanks, y'all.
Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Reba will be performing the national anthem at this year's Super Bowl. A lot of good performers this year at Super Bowl 58. Like I said, Reba will perform the national anthem. Andrea Day will perform Lift Every Voice and Sing ahead of the game. Post Malone will perform America the Beautiful. And Usher will perform the halftime show. A lot of people have mixed feelings about Usher doing the halftime show. I kind of am one of those people. Usher is, he's older, on the older side. I don't really know how much his music's going to connect with the younger audience, but hey, the Super Bowl's for everybody. I don't really know many older people, though, that like Usher. Usher's just kind of, eh. But Reba, you can't get no more powerful than this voice of Reba McEntire. And she'll be singing the national anthem. Now, Reba, to me, isn't the best singer in the world, but you can't deny the power of her voice. You can distinctly always tell when she's singing. But Super Bowl 58, folks, it is set. The final two teams are ready to battle it out on February the 11th. Brock Purdy and the San Francisco 49ers will play against Patrick Mahomes and the Kansas City Chiefs in Las Vegas at Allegiant Stadium. The Chiefs aim to win back-to-back titles for the first time since the 2003-2004 New England Patriots. They are heading into their sixth Super Bowl and making their fourth appearance in the past five seasons. I think it's safe to say that the Chiefs are the teams, is the team of the 20s. The 2020s, that is. It's no surprise that the 49ers made it to the Super Bowl after the impressive season that they had this year. 12-5, as a matter of fact, was their overall record. So, we've got the favorite, the 49ers, taking on the Chiefs. But really, I think the Chiefs have it in the bag. Super Bowl 58 will be the first time that an NFL championship game will be played not only in Las Vegas, but in Nevada. Interesting. So, before the big game in just 2 weeks, I want to tell you everything you need to know about Super Bowl 58. It says here that Nevada is the 11th state to host a Super Bowl, and Las Vegas is the 19th city, while the stadium will be the 27th venue to ever host the Super Bowl. The next 3 years have already been set, the locations for the Super Bowl. Super Bowl 59 will be at Caesars Superdome in New Orleans. Super Bowl 60 will be at Levi's Stadium in Santa Clara, California. Super Bowl 61 will be at SoFi Stadium in Inglewood, California. Notice that all of those locations are always in warm climate. They don't want to take any risks on snow or rain for the Super Bowl. And if they do go to a colder climate, it's always in an indoor stadium. The current stadium that the Super Bowl this year will be in only seats 65,000 people, which is a small amount of people compared to most NFL arenas. The quarterbacks who have the most Super Bowl wins, Tom Brady, of course, at 7, Joe Montana at 4, Terry Bradshaw at 4, and Troy Aikman at 3. Patrick Mahomes could get his third one and be included amongst these incredible names I just mentioned if he gets his third one this year. So the teams who have the most Super Bowls, the Pittsburgh Steelers have 6, the Patriots have 6, the Dallas Cowboys have 5, and the team that's in it this year, San Francisco 49ers, have 5. So if the 49ers win this year, they will be tied with the Patriots and Steelers as the team with the most Super Bowls. How much are the Super Bowl commercials this year? According to multiple sources, it says here that a 30-second ad for the 2024 Super Bowl will be $7 million. That's the same cost as the 2023 Super Bowl. Everything else has went up, but hey, look on the bright side. Commercials for the Super Bowl didn't go up. They're only going to cost you a whopping $7 million for 30 seconds. I wonder how effective that really is. I mean, yes, you're going to have so many eyeballs on you during the Super Bowl, but really, how effective is a Super Bowl commercial? Because you can play that same ad the next day for a $10 million cheaper, and I wonder how, really just how impactful advertising during the Super Bowl is. But it must be. I am sure that there have been many, many, many studies on exactly like, who knows? Who knows? So I just wonder how effective a Super Bowl commercial is. But folks, I feel like that this is a good time to take Off the Cuff's Song of the Week break. So sit back and enjoy a little Fall Out Boy with My Songs, Know What You Did in the Dark. We'll be back after the song. Right, let's see, let's go. Elaine says it's 52 degrees in Ohio. That's nice. What's up, Wag? Leona, Valerie, Cindy, Darlis, 62, Elaine says. Hello, Tim, Margie, Sherry, Mary. Hey, Mary. Hello to you as well. Hope everything is going good in your neck of the woods. Hope you're staying safe and out of trouble. Yeah, so I try to get on the live as much as possible before a show. Sometimes I do shows where I don't go live, but I always feel like it's just a great extra antidote. Now, there's a lot of audio that you probably didn't hear on the live, so you have to actually go to the broadcast to hear it. But you'll hear it on the podcast. If you go back and listen on podcast, you'll hear the broadcast in its entirety. Off the Cuff's quote of the week comes from H. Jackson Brown Jr., who was an American author and best known for his inspirational book, Life's Little Instruction Book, which was a New York Times bestseller from 1991 to 1994. Its sequel, Life's Little Instruction Book, Volume 2, also made it to the same bestseller list in 1993. Work for recognition. But do work worthy of recognition. And I love that quote because so many of us, we do things so we can get recognized. And I get it. Being recognized is a great feeling. For instance, I was just nominated for a Lexington Music Award here in Kentucky. And I was nominated for my work on the radio. Yes, it felt good. But folks, I don't do this for recognition, but I do work that's worthy for the recognition. I don't want to be recognized for something, and I don't go out to do something just to get recognized. I want to get recognized because people feel like it's worthy to get recognized for it. I don't do this just so you can say, look at me, look at what all he can do, look at what I do do. I do this, and I try to do good work so you can make your own decision and say, you know what, that is worth recognizing. That's why it does really feel good to get recognized being nominated for a Lexington Music Award for Best Radio DJ. Because I didn't do radio to get recognition, but I'm glad that my work is finally getting recognized. And everybody should apply that concept to their life. Don't do things just to go out and get recognized. Don't help people out just to let people see that you're doing a good deed so people can say, oh, look at him. Look how nice and helpful and kind he is. But let your work speak for itself. And when it does, people will recognize that. People will recognize that. All right, folks, we still have one more segment to go. Stick with us. We will be right back.
Mimi huwa na shughuli nyingi kwa ajili ya familia yangu na kusaidia jamii yangu. Kila najua nikijali niyo njia bora ya afya njema kwa wapendwa wangu. Tuiweke jamii yetu salama. Usisubiri hadi uwe mgonjwa ili uone daktari. Kuwa mwangalifu, chukua hatua. Ujumbe huu umetoka kwa Radio Lex, kituo cha radio cha jamii yetu. Pata maelezo zaidi kwa radiolex.us.
Let's go places safely, Lexington. Do you have enough room on the road? Make sure to leave a safe distance buffer between you and the car in front of you.
Hey, Mary and Kathy.
Buffer between you and the car behind you. What's a safe distance? Use the 2-second rule. No matter how fast you're going, keep 2 seconds of road between you and the car in front of you. Choose any marker on the side of the road, a sign, a cone, a crack in the pavement. From the time the rear bumper of the vehicle in front of you passes the marker, make sure you count 2 seconds before you reach the marker with the front of your car. Hi, I'm Susan Elkington from Toyota, reminding you to be ready to react by leaving a safe distance between your car and the others on the road.
Peace up, A-Town.
Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Last segment of the hour. This may be the most popular Usher song out there. I don't know anybody who knows many Usher songs, but everybody knows this song. And at least when you hear it, you might not know who sings it, but you recognize it. You'll say to yourself, I've heard this song before. And if you've not heard this song before, you've not went to enough dance clubs in your life. It's a good song. Usher, a big performer at this year's Super Bowl because he is doing the halftime show. Did you know that most people that do the halftime show, they fund the entire halftime show out of their own pocket? It's a misconception to think you get paid a bunch of money to do the halftime show. No, the NFL does not pay you a dime to do the halftime show. You have to do it for free. As a matter of fact, you have to pay out of your own pocket for your performance. And the trade-off, how they rationalize the trade-off, is the NFL is saying, we can put you in front of the whole world for 15 minutes. And that's basically they're saying how we pay you. And I get that. I think it's worth the exposure. I think that funding it out of your pocket, what you get out of the exposure from being a halftime performer, I think it's worth it. because usually if you do a really good job at the halftime show, your career almost has a rebirth. Your records start selling again. All of a sudden, people want to see you, so you go on tour, which means you're going to make more money. So it does nothing but help you. So I can see why they don't pay you anything. Folks, it being February the 1st, it does mean that it is Black History Month. And last year on the show for Black History Month, every Thursday in February, I would pick an African-American figure and give them tribute. And last year on the show, we did figures such as Martin Luther King, Rosa Parks. We did some black inventors. Well, today, our next African-American figure that I would like to pay tribute to is Harriet Tubman, who was a brave leader during the Underground Railroad movement. Harriet Tubman escaped from slavery and spent 11 years guiding other enslaved people to freedom through the Underground Railroad as a conductor. Tubman was also a spy, scout, nurse, and soldier during the Civil War for the Union Army. And I find that so admirable that she helped people escape from slavery. She didn't just want to get out of slavery to help herself, just to help her family. She wanted to help all of her brothers and sisters, all of the African Americans who were trapped in slavery. It boggles my mind that we lived in a world that had that, but we did. And Harriet Tubman is one of the biggest figures in the world, especially in the African American community, because of her contributions of helping people escape through that Underground Railroad. It was because of her that railroad, the Underground Railroad, even was orchestrated as well as it went. She was known as the railroad conductor. It was like it was her train that she was conducting, getting everybody out of there. And because of that, she is worthy to be mentioned and pay tribute on today's episode. But folks, that pretty much wraps up another episode of Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. If you liked what you heard, you'll probably like our previous episodes. We post all episodes on podcast. We're on Apple Podcast, we're on Spotify, we're on YouTube, wherever you download major podcasts, you can find Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. You can follow the show on social media at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. You can follow me, the host, on social media at The Adam Banks. We release new episodes every Thursday from 4 to 5 right here on WLXU 93.9 FM, which means I will be back same time, same place. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Adam Banks, and this is Off the Cuff. Thank you for listening to the King of Radio. I'll be back next week. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. Yes, they do not get paid for the halftime show, Kathy. That's crazy, isn't it? You would think that they would because the NFL's got all the money in the world, but it's interesting to know that the trade-off is just for the exposure. Have a great week, everybody. I'll see you next week.